Thank you, Brendan, for that very warm introduction. And can I thank you and IPA for your ongoing support of the government's activities here in New South Wales. We're proud of our achievement in the infrastructure space. And we know we owe it in large part to many of you in this room who have enthusiastically taken up our challenge to be involved and enthusiastically encourage us to go further. Can I also acknowledge my ministerial colleagues who are here, Minister Harwin and Minister Gowan, and thank them publicly for their hard work in ensuring our government remains disciplined and focused on the issues that matter most to the great people of this state. I also want to acknowledge the board and all the patrons of IPA, and of course many, many leaders in government, industry and the private sector who are in this room. There's no doubt that the success story that is New South Wales in the infrastructure space is really unprecedented when we talk about the scale of what we're doing and what we've managed to change and achieve in the last 6 years. And there's no doubt when we came to government there'd been a massive underinvestment in infrastructure. The budget position was very weak. In fact, there were we inherited deficits, huge debt, and lack of capacity to actually deliver what the O'Farrell and then Baird and now Berejiklian governments wanted to achieve. So we knew we had our work cut out for us in making New South Wales the economic and infrastructure powerhouse it is today. And what I would like to do today is briefly outline what we've achieved, what we're doing now, and what we hope to do in the future. And one thing I really want to stress more than ever is that there will be no down tools in New South Wales. Everyone who is active in the space here in New South Wales can be assured that not only will we maintain the vigour and enthusiasm of our infrastructure pipeline, but in fact, we're only looking at the next generation of projects that will take our state to the next level. And our infrastructure pipeline is well documented. I'll just give you some of the headline acts, which Brendan kindly mentioned. In the last 6 years, we've managed a lot, and people take for granted that at the end of last year, on budget and on time, we delivered the International Convention Centre, which is now the regional headquarters of major conventions in New South Wales. It's the Asia Pacific's premier convention and exhibition centre. I'm so pleased to the IPA for recognising that at your recent awards. That's just one example of what we managed to do in our efficient way of delivering major public major infrastructure. And of course, when it comes to public transport, we're bringing Metro to Sydney, New South Wales for the first time. The Northwest Rail Line is going gangbusters, and Stage 2 is already in process, which is a second harbour rail crossing and then metrification all the way down to Bankstown. Light Rail, you probably noticed Light Rail going through the middle of the CBD out to the southeast, and also Parramatta and Newcastle. And I remember when we embarked on the Light Rail project, people said Sydney will shut down, you won't be able to do it. In fact, Sydney has grown beyond expectations. In fact, the private investment that's come off the back of that project has been phenomenal. Every major building is getting upgraded pretty much along George Street, and a lot of private investment is backing in that project as an example of how you can actually ensure concurrence of public investment and private investment when you are investing in this major infrastructure. And of course, WestConnex is the largest motorway project in the nation. It's the largest project in the nation, and it's the biggest congestion busting project we have, and we're very excited by the innovative way in which we're delivering that. Similarly, NorthConnex is a major road project which will bypass 21 traffic lights. So we expect that to be completed in 2019. And I know this is a really interesting thing to imagine, but you will essentially, when NorthConnex is completed, be able to drive from Newcastle to Melbourne without stopping at a single traffic light, essentially. So that's a pretty major achievement. And of course, there's many other projects we have, whether it's in health, education, our sporting and cultural infrastructure. And one that I'm particularly proud of, and I know that Brendan Lyon has been such a strong support to government on this, is social housing. We recently announced stage one of our social and affordable housing fund, where there'll be 2,200 dwellings built throughout the New South Wales as part of stage one, involving the private sector and the NGO sector. But of course, it's not just the bricks and mortar that we're providing innovative solutions to. And I know many of you are involved in some of the exciting projects we have on the operations side, and how we can improve customer service and how we can enhance the experience that all our clients, when I say clients, whether our patients or transport users or students, experience is in large part attributed to the great support many of you provide. I thought what I would do is share some insights now that I can look back on 6 years on why we have achieved this success. And I wanted to stress at the outset that it was really important for us to bring together the best minds around the nation. So we did, when we first came to government, look around the nation for best people in both government and the private sector who knew how to run projects, who knew how to reform the public sector, and knew how to build relationships with key stakeholders. So I can't emphasise how important it was for us to gather the right human capital, and we're still in that process, but it's fantastic that because of this innovative approach, we have been able to attract and maintain the best and brightest from around the nation, and some of them whom are in this room. I want to acknowledge Head of Treasury, who's here, Rob Whitfield, the Chair of Infrastructure New South Wales, Graham Bradley, and many others who have supported the government in our initiatives. Of course, we established Infrastructure New South Wales, which has given government that discipline and that independent, robust nurturing it takes to bring projects to life. And of course, Infrastructure New South Wales' role has changed as the government has changed. So yes, Infrastructure New South Wales was initially established to provide government with independent, robust advice on project prioritisation, but now they're fulfilling a very important role alongside that one of assurance and making sure all of our projects are on time and on budget. And that is a really key and important role that Infrastructure New South Wales is supporting government on. And of course, as Brendan mentioned, our asset recycling strategy has really allowed us to find the billions of dollars we need to support our infrastructure pipeline. And so far, we've netted about $27 billion in the last 6 years, and there's more to come. We've got two interesting transactions underway as we speak. But there's no doubt our asset recycling strategy and our guts to be able to do that. And I pay tribute to both premiers, especially Premier Baird, for having the courage to take that to the community and explain that through asset recycling, you can actually provide the infrastructure the community has needed and wanted for decades. And of course, you also need fiscal discipline. So from day one, we've made sure that our budget processes are robust, that we keep an eye on expenses. If you look around the other states around Australia, one failing is they don't manage to contain their expenses growth, and that reduces their ability to provide surpluses and invest in infrastructure. And also, of course, an interesting challenge to have is once you complete a piece of infrastructure, you then have to support the operating costs. And unless your budget is in check, unless you've got that fiscal rigour and discipline, you can't do that. And I've seen and watched other states fall into the trap of not being able to do that because they've failed to have that requisite fiscal discipline. And of course, I'm very proud of the fact, and many of you around this room have helped achieve the innovative funding and delivery models we have for projects. And another key learning for me personally is that you can't have a one model for every single project you're delivering. We know that one size doesn't fit all in terms of funding and delivery models for infrastructure. In fact, quite the opposite. And we seek a practical solution to meet the needs of each infrastructure project. So we look at the project, what is the best delivery method, how can we do it most efficiently, and what kind of models can we adopt for that particular project. And for instance, stages 1 and 2 of WestConnex are being delivered by the Sydney Motorway Corporation, a government-owned Corporations Act company, and financed by the combination of state equity, private debt, and federal government debt. And that's a unique way in which we're delivering that project, and very innovative. And interestingly, it's on balance sheet, but off metrics in terms of the AAA, and it's a very innovative way in which we can deliver major infrastructure. Similarly, another example is the CBD and Southeast Light Rail project is being delivered by an availability payment PPP, as was the International Convention Centre. Sydney Metro Northwest is also being delivered by PPP, and NorthConnex is being delivered as a patronage risk PPP, augmented by changes to existing concessions in the Sydney Motorway network. So there are just some examples of the different delivery models. And then when you look at other projects like the Princess Highway upgrade, Berry to Bomaderry bypass down south, or the Pacific Highway upgrades up north, they're being delivered as traditional design and construct contracts. So we will look at the project, look at the best delivery method, and if there's a delivery method that hasn't been considered, we will also consider that as the best way to deliver that project most efficiently, keeping an eye on the government's balance sheet. But of course, another key aspect is robust assurance. It's not enough to get a project off the ground and to get your partners. You need to make sure that you have strengthened your assurance process. And we're really pleased as a government that we have strengthened the infrastructure assurance process for our projects through the implementation of what we call the Infrastructure Investor Assurance Framework. And the implementation of this framework has created a single point of responsibility for the independent assessment of capital projects across government, which is led by Infrastructure New South Wales. And INSW leads the investor insurance framework, and again, providing independent oversight to ensure all of our projects are on time and on budget. And I have to say, all of our ministers do an incredible job in micromanaging and making sure we hit all our critical paths and milestones. But it's also great to know there's an independent body overseeing that process to make sure nothing falls through the cracks. And of course, this robust assurance process also means that we capture learnings. So every time you enter a new contract or new project, you take with you the learnings of accumulated intellect and accumulated experience, which you can then refine for the next project you're doing. And what I think is understated here in New South Wales is everybody knows we're an economic powerhouse and we're doing well. And whilst I note that IPA acknowledged Victoria, we're leaving them in the shade, I have to say. But I think what is underestimated is how government invested in infrastructure actually has such enormous benefits beyond the actual productive infrastructure you're building. And I just wanted to talk about some of those because I don't think it often gets enough attention. But obviously economic growth, New South Wales has the fastest growth we've had. They used to say since the Olympics, but it's actually before the Olympics. So even including the Olympics, New South Wales is growing faster than any other economy in Australia. And in 15-16 financial year, New South Wales GSP grew by 3.5%, the fastest in the country and the first time in more than 25 years that New South Wales has been the fastest growing state, so which is a really important legacy. And the latest state final demand figures show New South Wales has the strongest growth in 2016. And our state final demand grew by 4.7% in 2016 and it grew just 0.2% in the rest of Australia. So if that doesn't tell you how well New South Wales is doing, I don't know what does. But put another way, the New South Wales economy provided 90% of all demand growth in 2016. So I'll leave that with you. But of course, this record and our strong budget position, which as you know, has virtually no debt, is in surplus with billions to spend on infrastructure, AAA credit rating, I'll stop showing off, has also inspired private investment and enhanced business confidence. I hope you agree with that. So strong fiscal management and infrastructure delivery are vital for business confidence, and New South Wales is the only state with growing business investment. So in 2016, New South Wales business investment grew by over 9%. That's just in 1 year. Across the other states, business investment fell by over 15%. So we're growing very healthily, whereas regrettably, it's not the case in other states. And New South Wales businesses are building today and also supporting us in jobs growth. And in New South Wales, our unemployment is just 5.2%, which is the lowest in the nation. It's by far the lowest of any state. And if you remove New South Wales from the national figures, the unemployment rate for the rest of Australia would be 6.2%, a 4 percentage point higher. But again, our infrastructure spend has spurred on job creation. So in the last 2 years alone, we've created 114,000 jobs in New South Wales, and that's in large part because of our infrastructure spend, but also because of the commensurate private investment that comes with that infrastructure spend. So when we're building a new rail line or a new road project, it does spur on private investors to also build things in and around those infrastructure projects. And I'm very proud to say that in the last 6 years, we've created or added more than 300,000 jobs in New South Wales, which is a rise of 8.6% in the number of jobs. And just one project, WestConnex, will generate about 10,000 jobs directly and indirectly, including hundreds of opportunities for apprentices and trainees, but there's similar figures for our metro projects, our light rail projects, and that doesn't include, obviously, the secondary and tertiary jobs created through private investment along those projects as well. But it's also important now when other jurisdictions come to New South Wales and talk to me and my colleagues about infrastructure, they're really interested in our skills-based and jobs training here in the state. Everybody knows that to be To be able to continue to deliver infrastructure of this scale, you need the right people with the right skills, and you need to make sure there's enough of them, especially when you've got a lot happening at the one time. But I'm so thrilled with the skill base we have here developing in New South Wales. So when you build projects, you develop that skill base, but we also have huge net migration from WA and Queensland. People who were skilled previously on mining projects are now applying those skills to infrastructure projects, which means that we're able to obviously keep an eye on escalation costs, which unfortunately in other jurisdictions overseas, wages growth has been a huge impediment to them maintaining their costs over the life of a project. And of course, this success does also engender public confidence and also business confidence, so that when we do announce we're building something, I remember in 2011 when I announced the Northwest Metro, Northwest Rail Link, people said it'll never happen. I remember when I said we're going to build light rail, people said it never happens. And now when Minister Constance announces something, they say, when is it coming down my street? Let me know. And so that change in attitude over 6 years has really been a shift in the public's appreciation that we're a government that actually gets on with the job and builds. And I have to say that's backed up by, I hope, private sector confidence as well in our processes and the robustness of our processes, and also the expertise of the people they're dealing with through the New South Wales government. And I'm also pleased to say that one unintended but positive consequence, obviously, it's not unintended, but it's not a fact that apart from treasurers and a few other people take a lot of interest in, but our strong operating surpluses, our asset recycling and construction of productive infrastructure has meant that our net worth as a state is forecast to be $203 billion by June 2017. The state's net worth is estimated to rise to $248 billion by June 2020, growing faster than any other mainland state. So we're actually seeing the value of our asset base and our balance sheet grow substantially as a result. And I'm so proud of that. Again, not everybody in the community would appreciate what that means, but it means that every bit of infrastructure we're building is actually adding to our state's net worth in combination with the other things we're doing. And of course, in terms of the future, I can assure everybody that our infrastructure agenda will continue at a faster pace. We are doing better than we anticipated in some areas, so therefore we do have additional funds to ensure that we continue to deliver the infrastructure that is needed most by our communities in those areas in which they need them. And we know the challenges are huge. We are doing well, but we know, for example, Sydney's population's already exceeded 5 million, but our state population is set to grow from 7.6 million to around 11.2 million by 2056. And so to meet that growing population, you need to make sure you have the infrastructure in place. And also to ensure that you provide quality of life. There's nothing worse than spending too much of your day in congestion or too much of your day travelling to and from your destination, as opposed to having the options and choices to live and work in your community, which added infrastructure provides. If you're creating jobs and building communities, not just in the CBD, but throughout the state and throughout Greater Sydney, that also enhances quality of life by the infrastructure you're providing. And at the end of the day, that's why we're all in government, to improve quality of life, give people the choices they want, and allow everybody to be their best no matter where they live in the state. And certainly that is why we have the fiscal discipline we have and why we have the infrastructure agenda we have. And we are already, it's no secret, as a government, working on the next generation of infrastructure projects. And I'm also proud of the fact that many other jurisdictions are now seeking our advice on innovative funding models, innovative ways of raising capital, and also supporting the relationships between private sector and non-government organisations. Because, as you all know, unless you have good project managers on all sides of the equation, unless you have strong skill base on all sides of the equation, you cannot have the success that we've had to date. But our story is still one of watch this space. We have come a lot, very far in the past 6 years, but obviously much more to do. And we will not squib on those difficult decisions which need to be taken to make sure we do continue to provide leadership in the way things are done, but also leadership in the way in which governments can and should deliver strong budgets, strong economic conditions, and a strong and healthy infrastructure pipeline, because all those things go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other, and you have to have all those things hand in hand. Again, I want to just conclude my remarks by thanking all of you for being here today, for being part of the success story that is New South Wales, And I failed to acknowledge at the beginning, but I wanted to give a special thanks to the former First Father of New South Wales, Bruce Baird, and also say to him, he's also a very good friend, but also say to him that a lot of what we were able to pick up in 2011 was a lot of the legacy Bruce Baird left when he was a transport minister. And when I first got the job, he was the first one to come and mentor me and give me the courage to take some bold decisions. And I remember at the time going to Cabinet and saying, I need $8 billion to build a new rail line in the Northwest. And I need X billion dollars to build this or build that. Were tough asks initially, but we managed to now create the pipeline. And full credit to all my colleagues, especially Minister Constance, Minister Pavey and Minister Gay, before Minister Pavey, for really driving part of that government's roads and transport agenda. But also we have a team, a strong team in government. And I know Minister Goward, for example, has spent a lot of time and energy in the social housing infrastructure space. And we're looking forward to doing stage two, working with IPA and other stakeholders. And of course, Minister Howard now has the huge challenge of working with me in the government and ensuring our energy security into the future. And these are the challenges we welcome and relish. And I also want to stress that New South Wales will continue to be the thought leader for the nation in how we believe things can be done most efficiently, productively, and at the end of the day, in a most customer-centric way, because at the end of the day, we need to make sure everything we do puts the customer or the user at the heart of everything we do. So thank you so much for allowing me to be here and for sharing a status update on where we're up to and where we're going, and look forward to seeing you and working with you into the future. Because we are hugely indebted, because many of you in this room have contributed to the government's intellectual rigour, experience and delivery of these major projects. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Premier. As I indicated before the Premier's address, she's open for questions from the floor. For those of you who've joined us at IPA events before, you'll know that if I don't see hands going up, I'll just start naming people randomly in the room. Could I ask four questions from the floor? Robert Peck.
Premier, thank you for that talk. I have to say our heritage comes from Victoria, and it doesn't please me at all to see that you're pinching all our people from Victoria up to your New South Wales protectorate. But you did mention unintended consequences, and you did mention quality of life. And my question really is that a number of your public servants here in this room are fighting what seems to us to be a back-ended battle. We are design advisors on the Convention Centre Northwest and on the Parramatta Road, the WestConnex. That they battle to argue for the quality of life that you so clearly hold dear. And my question simply is, what can we do politically to ensure that the public servants who are battling to get really good quality urban design and landscaping around some of these 100-year exercises to achieve the results they're looking for? I just don't hear it politically at this stage, other than in your speech, and I commend you for it.
Yeah, no, thank you. But for us, it's really important to make sure that both during construction and post-construction, we leave the environment and the community in a better place than what we found. And that's extremely important to us. And you'll find that when we are issuing tenders for major projects, and no matter how large or small the contract is, there are other non-financial criteria we look at. So it's not just best price, but it's best quality. For example, with the CBD Southeast Light Rail project, and I should have mentioned that project not only has enormous public transport benefits, but also allows Sydney to become the events capital of Australia in terms of getting to major events. But for that one project alone, we're planting 8 trees for every one we have to remove. And that was definitely part of our EIS process. So we are making every effort we can during and post-construction, not only to restore the community, but actually to enhance it. And I remember a particular experience, for those of you who don't know Sydney that well, but in the deep north around Cherrybrook, we had to build a new station for the metro. And I cannot tell you how upset the community was for having to go through that transition. But now they're so pleased because they've got more greenery and more proximity to open space than what they did beforehand. It's actually enhance and improve the community. So I think if you do have the right design, if you do take the time to be detailed during the planning process, you can get a better outcome. We're getting better at it as time goes on, no doubt about it. But that's why it's important when we are issuing tenders and establishing partnerships with the private sector, but also within ourselves, within agencies, that we do focus on other non-price issues. Quality, amenity, environment, customer service and use. Often a lot of our decision making is around, well, how does this help the customer? And sometimes, you know, you will pay a bit more for something, but knowing full well it will have a better customer consequence because the government has its ideas on what it needs to do. And then when we start engaging with the private sector, they say, well, did you realise that, you know, you'll improve this if you do that and whatever. Treasurers hate those conversations because it normally means project scopes increase at the beginning, but it does mean a better product in terms of the customer and the urban environment. But thank you for the question, it's timely.
Amy Brown and then Roger Massey-Green.
Hi, Premier Berejiklian and Amy Brown from PwC. I thought it'd be predictable and ask you a question because I tend to do that when you're speaking. But you don't need to go get an AVO out on me just yet. I'm quite harmless. I get the impression from the Social and Affordable Housing Fund projects, and congratulations on those, and indeed your capital recycling program, that your government is not particularly obsessed with owning stuff. And so where it has a better value outcome for government or service outcome for the customer, you're happy for the non-government sector to own the asset or the facility that the service is occurring within. Focusing on social infrastructure and services still, I was wondering how you're proposing to approach the other sectors. Will it be with a similar mindset, or are there any sectors in particular that are kind of off limits and you don't want non-government sector involvement in the provision of the asset or the asset solution itself?
Yeah. No, we are open to consider anything which we believe enhances and improves what the taxpayers of this state have. And so another area of investment we've opened up and we're actually the national lead on is social impact investment. And Minister Goward would know that we're spending a lot of time, for example, we have unfortunately 20,000 children in out-of-home care in New South Wales, and that trend hasn't changed for decades in terms of the number of children part of that system. So for decades, governments have thrown more money at it without actually changing the outcome and the result. So we're looking at, you know, it's small scale at this stage, but working with the private sector who put up the finance and the NGOs who provide the on-the-ground support. And this is a great example where the private sector is actually making sure the NGOs keep their KPIs because they have a financial interest. The NGO has the experience and wants to make sure they help the social outcome. And they're achieving better results than government. I mean, it's small scale, but it just demonstrates that we are willing to look at anything which improves the quality of life or improves the customer experience. And some of you in the room may have maybe looking at our social impact investment program. And this year we've also started a social impact investment in recidivism. Unfortunately, there's too many repeat offenders, and rather than building more jails, we want to try and encourage people not to go into jail. And so we have a program there to see that. And we've also establishing one in palliative care to see if there's better models governments can adopt to how we support the most vulnerable. So I believe if you involve the non-government sector, the experts on the ground, the private sector in terms of supporting and providing some rigour to the NGOs who might not have that expertise, but government being a regulator and making sure that everyone is protected in the system seems to be a very good formula for areas which were previously no-go zones for anybody but government. But government doesn't have all the solutions, and so we're really interested in examining what can be perhaps a better solution for people who are most vulnerable.
Roger.
Premier, this is Citizen Massey-Green. But just want to say, firstly, you know, few of us in the room have heard such a magnificent exposition of performance of government, so congratulations to you and your colleagues for what you've achieved. You spoke about social housing, and then so it's just tremendous to see some of the asset recycling proceeds going towards social housing. And you referred to stage two of the social housing program. Perhaps you can tell us a bit more about your plans in that area.
I can't yet, Roger, because we haven't announced it, but we'll be ready in due course. But we know there's a lot of interest. But it's really disappointing that you know, we're often, if I can be political for a second, Liberal governments are regarded as great economic managers, great infrastructure builders, and not given enough credibility for supporting the most vulnerable. And here we have a Liberal national government delivering thousands of extra dwellings for those who can't afford market rates in social and affordable housing, and it barely got a word written up about it. So that's something I mention all the time. Oh, Sean's just waved. That means he's going to write something about it from the Herald. But I guess we're equally proud that we're using using our expertise to not just generate economic activity, growth and strengthen New South Wales through the obvious means, but also doing what governments need to do is supporting the most vulnerable. So that's a good example of where you use your economic expertise and asset recycling to support those who can't support themselves. And we're in a strong position to be able to do that. But we were fortunate in that we had $1.1 billion seed funding we were able to put in that fund. Not every government around Australia can afford that. But we are in such a strong financial position that we're able to do that. And that seed funding will now generate, you know, thousands and thousands of dwellings, and stage two we'll be having something to say publicly about soon.
Thank you. I told a lie to you all at the start when I said journalists weren't allowed to ask questions, so we have three on that table, Sean.
Thanks. Hi, Premier. Sean Nicholls from the Herald, as you know.
I do know very well.
As you'd also know, IPA was very, very supportive of your government's decision to lease 49% of the poles and wires and take that to the last state election. I was hoping you might share with the room today your thoughts on the prospect of increasing the amount of those assets that the public, that the private sector might be able to lease in order to release some more money for public works.
There are no such plans, Mr. Nicholls.
Can you elaborate on that?
I've been pretty definitive, but as you know, we do have two exciting transactions as we speak. So the government's asset recycling strategy is ongoing, but we've already shared with the community what we're doing. So we have the Endeavour transaction going through a critical phase, as we do with LPI. And so we're always looking at opportunities, but we also feel very strongly that we need to consider, obviously, what the public thinks as well. That's been our track record. I have to say the public is becoming more and more accustomed to better service quality, more frequent service, affordability and a strong regulatory framework. I remember the hassles we went through when we franchised Sydney Ferries, but who now even remembers or knows that the private sector runs Sydney Ferries? And I remember at the time we had 28 vessels but 8 unions to deal with, and the process was relatively seamless. And customers now get a better go, they can buy a drink, they can get to, you know, the fast ferry, 2 options or 3 options that exist with fast ferries, as well as increasing services, are a great example of where you have a strong regulator in the government which controls pricing, makes sure the system is one network. So in our vision, we have one integrated network, roads and transport, but for the customer, it's seamless. In the back office, we manage all the complications, but as far as the customer is concerned, it's seamless experience. And when you provide that value to the public transport user or to others in the community, that's a pretty positive proposition. So they worry less about the source of service, so long as they have confidence that the government is monitoring everything, keeping prices down and ensuring certain, you know, minimum service standards. And I think more and more the public are becoming amenable to that. And who would have thought, 30 or 40 years ago, when even Bruce Baird was a transport minister, building a toll road was so horrifically controversial. I mean, no one wanted to pay a cent for using a new road, but now it's become, you know, we have people saying, just build me the road, give me an extra half hour with my family every day, I'll pay a couple of bucks for it, but I want an extra half, you know, that's more important to me than, you know, obviously having the free option as well, but that's more important, that half an hour extra, for some people it's an extra hour a day, is more important to me than sitting in traffic, and I'm happy to pay a couple of bucks to get that 1 hour back of my life every day. And also as employers, I want more productive staff, and also with public transport, actually giving people the option to jump on a metro or a southwest rail line or an inner west light rail link rather than jump in a car is also something which many parts of the community are grabbing with gusto. And I hear lots of things anecdotally, but also on paper, a lot of Gen Ys would rather go overseas than buy a car. And their choices are also driving a lot of the public transport shift. And Minister Constance will tell you that the increase in patronage has really been phenomenal in the last few years compared to the previous decade. And that will likely continue, obviously, with the mass transit options coming online. That was a very long answer to your short question.
G'day. Michael Rodden from the Australian newspaper. I wanted to know what you made of this idea about the federal government opening up super for first home buyers at a time when, as I understand it, the government is considering switching stamp duty for land tax. Are you worried that a proposal such as that will make Sydney houses even more unaffordable?
The second part of your question, I don't know where you've made that assumption, but we certainly haven't.
It was the Sydney Morning Herald.
All actually. Right, yeah. I risk my case, no. I'll answer the question in this way. Clearly the best way, and every expert will tell you this, and I am so grateful, when I rang Glenn Stevens, former head of the Reserve Bank, and said, can you please help us in our housing affordability package? Because the biggest mistake that governments make is they can be very well intentioned, but deliver things which have unintended consequences, which create further heat and push up prices for new aspiring home entrants. So the basic premise always is in New South Wales and anywhere, frankly, that supply is the best way to deal with housing affordability, no doubt about that. But I've also said that nothing's off the table and we are considering demand side options as well. And that's about all I'll say on that. We'll have more to say during the budget process. But one thing I'm incredibly proud of is because of our huge infrastructure spend in the growth areas like the Northwest, the Southwest, the Greater West, and also in the regions, we're actually building new housing at affordable rates outside the CBD. Unfortunately, in Brisbane and Melbourne, all their new units are in the CBD, which doesn't really help people who are trying to get into the market for the first time. That tends to be, especially in Melbourne, that tends to be a particular price point. But in Sydney, you can go to places like Penrith and Blacktown and Parramatta and aspire to have to buy your first home. And so I'm really pleased that our infrastructure program has meant people don't mind living in communities which are a bit further out, including places like Box Hill in the northwest and Rouse Hill, because they'll know they'll jump on a metro train and get anywhere in the network in a reasonable amount of time. So housing affordability obviously is driven by supply, can have some demand solutions as well, but you have to be careful of the unintended consequences. But I'd also argue, which is we're in an IPA lunch, that our investment in infrastructure in those growth communities is allowing additional supply. And so you cannot underestimate the positive impact of that. I didn't really include it in my list of points, but it should have been the seventh point under benefits. But thank you for allowing me to expand on that now. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Premier. Kathleen Calderwood here from the ABC. The Auditor General's report...
Can everybody else who isn't a journalist ask me a question? Then I won't have to answer all the journalists' questions. Yeah, go for it.
The Auditor General's report released today has said that while there's good initiatives in place to deliver good train punctuality until 2019, it's going to be very difficult after that to run services on time unless capacity to carry more trains and passengers is significantly boosted. And as I'm sure you're aware, there's been serious consequences for the Queensland government because of poor train efficiencies. What are you going to do to avoid that post-2019?
Yeah. Firstly, please don't compare us to Queensland. But I will say, sorry, I don't mean to be disrespectful to any Queenslanders, but one of the reasons why we're building the Metro and the Northwest Metro will be open in 2019 is that it will increase capacity on our existing network by up to 60%. So when you're building a new rail line, yes, you'll have people using it who've never used public transport before, but you will also take pressure off the existing Western line and the North Shore line, depending on where people are going. So we're actually building for capacity and building for growth by investing the billions of dollars we are in our metro system. So the Auditor General's report isn't a surprise to us. We've actually been projecting that level of growth, which is why we've been, you know, from day one in government for 6 years, we've been furiously building our rail capacity. And not just that, but we've also improved our rolling stock, our systems, and maintenance program. We're investing more in maintenance now than we ever have. And in fact, we're getting a better deal for government. I remember one of the toughest decisions I took, which was anti my philosophy, but I insourced part of the maintenance to get a better deal for the taxpayer before we made sure we increased our maintenance. So everybody has been on notice in New South Wales that we're about improving existing systems, about improving travel times, but also about increasing services. There's been thousands and thousands of extra services, which increases capacity. So if you look at ferries, buses and trains, and the fact that we've increased, I think the number is, Minister Constance will know, but about 17,000 additional weekly transport services since we've been in government, that's all about capacity. And building the metro is all about capacity, not just building it on the new system, but also allowing more room on the existing system. And very proud of that legacy.
Premier, one of the most important metrics for me is your journey time reliability and on time running. So I'll bring the questions to an end there. But
see, I don't have to do a doorstop now because all the journalists have asked me all the questions.
Colleagues, on your behalf, I want to move a vote of thanks to the Premier, Gladys Berejiklian. I think it's been a tremendous address today, and particularly the core message around the state not slowing down and still being open for business is a point that's very well made in this room. So please join me in thanking the Premier for her remarks.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Colleagues, this concludes the formalities for today's events. I wanted in closing to once again thank Julian Peck from Morgan Stanley and also Lang O'Rourke's Mark Dimmick for their sponsorship and support for today's program. To thank my events team led by Rebecca Hardy for their work across the events. And most of all, to thank all of you in the room for your support for Infrastructure Partnerships Australia. Please have a good afternoon.